Just think of it as the rough draft of the podcast world. This is the Newbie Writers Podcast with your hosts, Damian Boak and Catherine Bramkamp.
Hey, this is episode 194 of the Newbie Writers Podcast. We're back for another week. Catherine, did you win?
Yes, I did.
Cheater. So for anyone that's curious, NaNoWriMo is National Novel Writing Month in November. Catherine missed that memo, did it in October, handed it in and said, woohoo, I win.
Did 50,000 in October, so I think I'm okay.
So I hopefully they confiscate it, but anyway.
That would be funny. I could knock on the door. We could have them on the show. I'll turn it into something good.
Yeah, and then, you know, drug testing, everything.
Yes.
Do they do that? Is it like the Olympics now? Has NaNoWriMo become that obsessed with winning?
That obsessed. That I think that considering the quote, the prizes are often simply the ability to pay for something with a 10% discount. I don't think that we're going to be knocking each other down like we do on Black Friday for a $25 VCR.
Ah, there's going to be no news reports out saying disgraced author, you know, shamed NaNoWriMo. All that
sort
of stuff.
Nothing like that. Nothing like that. Wouldn't that be great? I would love to be that important. Yeah. I'm just saying.
Give you 10% back. They get all they paid. Just thinking of.
Nope, nothing cool. So we have something better than talking about me cheating, which is interesting, but not better. We have our guest Meg Clayton on, and she has just written what is now the national bestseller, The Race for Paris.
Mm. Meg, welcome.
Thank you for having me, Damian and Catherine.
Now, Meg wouldn't have cheated on her books.
I can't do anything in 30 days.
Neither can I. Well, there, that answers that question. I was going to say, have you ever tried NaNo?
I actually have never tried it formally. I do like to write in big bursts like that. So for my second novel, for example, The Wednesday Sisters, I went away for 3 days in Southern California just by myself. This was when I had children at home, and I think I wrote 25,000 words in those 3 days. So it can be really, you know, once you've got a novel underway, it can be a really productive way to just turn out a draft. I think often we spend so much time, I know I do at least, or I used to, spend so much time pruning the words and making the prose just perfect for a early chapter that then ends up on the cutting room floor altogether.
Yeah.
Well,
so I do like blasting through a draft when I can.
I think, NaNo aside, this sort of month is a very sort of writers-focused month. And it seems that even if you're not doing it, people still get into the swing of wanting to do it. And, like, I checked our listener stats, and I worked it out. We've only had like 52% of our normal listeners. Okay. Come on, people.
Yeah, everybody's writing. Yeah. Everybody's busy writing.
Like, surely you can listen to this and write at the same time. I don't know. But look, even I did some writing.
Woo! So tell us about what you're working on, and then we'll get back to Meg, we promise.
Oh, well, I've been working on the Don't Write Like We Talk. I think we need to change that for people who are hungover like I might be this morning. I'm just working my way through each chapter and adding my bits and pieces. But I did have that issue, which, you know, we're going to talk about sort of a bit later or off air or whatever, was when it comes to the podcasting thing, that's my domain. And yeah, that's going to be like a whole section in itself.
Well, that's okay. That's okay. And, you know, like with anything, we'll just say, you know, if this looks boring, skip it.
Yeah, or just break it out and not include it. Maybe you could do a one-liner and just say, please refer to book two.
Well, we'll definitely see. We'll definitely see. Well, one of the things that I thought was interesting, Meg, because I loved your talk at the Copperfield book event, that you spent about 10 years really on this book, on the research and on writing it. Tell us a little bit about that, because, and I'll frame it, so often new writers, writers in general, we get a lot of information coming out of saying, write a book in 45 minutes, write a book over the weekend, and here you've got this really awesome book that that took you a while. So let's talk a little bit about that, because I'd like to advocate for a longer lead time for writing a book.
Yeah, absolutely. The truth is that I started writing this book before the turn of the century. And so when I actually fess up to the whole amount, it was actually about 15 years in the making. And in fairness, I published four other novels in those 15 years, and I wrote three of those four other novels and edited the fourth one. So it isn't like I spent 15 years writing this novel and nothing else. I wrote a lot of op-eds and short pieces and that kind of thing. But this was the novel that took me the longest to get together. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of reasons for that, you know. Part of it is the research, which, frankly, I love doing and could have done for another 15 years. You know, I got to spend my afternoons basking in the letters of Martha Gellhorn and the photographs and writing of Lee Miller and renting this lovely little apartment right on the Seine in Paris for months at a time.
Yeah, right? I was like, I'm sorry, I still have more to do, honey. Can't come home.
Exactly. No, actually, one of the beauties, my husband is also a writer, so I got to take him with me. So we actually had a really terrific time.
Then there'd be no reason to leave the country then. If you had your husband with you, it's all good.
That's exactly right. But the biggest bit of those 15 years was just wanting to get it right, you know, wanting to do justice to these, whom I think are extraordinary real women journalists who inspired the novel and have been largely forgotten. And so what happened was, you know, I wrote a first draft in the way we were just talking about writing first drafts. Uh-huh. I wrote it in fairly short order, I think. But it wasn't right. There was something fundamentally wrong about it. And every time I went back to it, I couldn't figure out what it was that was not working. All the pieces were there. The structure was there. And at some point very late in the process, you know, like year 13 or 14, it struck me that the problem was the narrative point of view. You know, what I was doing is I was reading The Great Gatsby. Mm-hmm. And The Great Gatsby is this story told from the perspective of Nick Carraway, who's a relatively minor character in the book.
Right.
But he's
right.
telling the story about these kind of larger-than-life people, mm-hmm. Gatsby and Daisy. And it struck me that that was part of my problem, is that I was trying to tell the story of a pretty big personality in terms of Liv Harper, my female photojournalist, American photojournalist, partially from her point of view. I'd had an alternating point of view between her and Fletcher Roebuck, who's a British military photographer. And so I looked around the story to see if there was a way to change that point of view. And there was a character that disappeared very early on in the early drafts of the book. Her name is Jane Tyler. She was a journalist from Nashville, Tennessee, where I lived for a number of years. And she was a bit of an homage to my great Aunt Marie, who went to the war with the Red Cross. And when I asked her why she went, she said, basically, "Well, honey, when the boys started going off to war, I've been teaching school for 6 years, and I looked around me and I saw when the last bachelor left town that I was going to be an old maid before he came back. And so I figured I'd better get on over there and find me a husband," which she did. And so I thought, well, maybe the Jane character could go with Liv when Liv goes AWOL, leaves the, you know, starts mm-hmm. breaking the rules, leaves where she's stationed and goes to the front. And let's try that. And when I tried that, mm-hmm. just like all these pieces that I had been struggling with for so many years, they just fell into place. And all of a sudden, the book started feeling like it was working for me. And so that's kind of how it, that's part of the reason why it took so long. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you that the other part of the reason was a publishing story, which I can share or not. It's up to you.
You can share the publishing story. We are publishing agnostic. We go either, you can do it yourself, you can do it others. We're happy to hear the bad and the good. So tell me about the publishing.
Well, hang on.
Go ahead, Damien.
I was going to say, just before you jump into that, I do have a very irrelevant question. Because I'm looking at your bio, and you said that you went off to become a doctor and emerged as a corporate lawyer. Now, my question for you is, did you go into the wrong classroom by mistake?
Yeah, it was called PChem, and I, you know, nearly failed it.
Hi, I would like to be a doctor. I'd like to, you know, work on people. And they go, well, you can work on people if you like. Here's the lawyers.
It's really interesting how one finds one way when one is in college. I'm always struck. I'll tell you that both of my sons went off to college and have emerged as exactly what they thought they wanted to be when they went in. And I'm Yeah, I was so struck by that because when I went into college, I didn't know enough about the opportunities there were in the world to know what I might want to be. I only had this vague sense that I wanted to do some good in the world, and it seemed like being a doctor would be a good way to do that. Yeah. So, and I also was pretty good in the maths and sciences, and frankly, I sucked at English.
Don't say that. Here's the other thing then, and this can lead into the publishing thing, being a corporate lawyer, you must be the bane of publishers then. So when they give you a contract, do you just go and say, look, I'm a corporate lawyer, try again, and send it back?
But, you know, the way the publishing world works, authors don't necessarily have all that much power. And so when I was signing my contract for my first book, I told my agent, I said, I'd really like to change this. And she said, they never change that. And I said, well, I just to tell you that me as a lawyer is advising me as a client not to sign this, but nonetheless, I am signing it. It turned out that I was right, that they actually, that publisher changed that clause all the time, and my agent just had never asked. So I learned from that experience to ask, and I do actually negotiate my contracts. Everybody comes around, but it isn't always easy at the start.
I wonder why.
No, it's not easy because they you know, I had our lawyer look at my contract with the first Future Girls book, and he comes back and he says, I don't even know why you people sign this kind of stuff. And I said, because we have no choice.
Exactly. And you know, and frankly, that's part of how the Race for Paris came about. Actually, was I had been publishing with Random House, and I'd pitch the Race of Paris every time they asked me to pitch a new book. You know, the story goes kind of like this. You know, they really liked how well the Wednesday Sisters, you know, was positioning even before it came out. And they said, would you like to, you know, do a deal for a new book? And I said, sure. And they said, what, you have some ideas? I said, I have this World War II book. And they said, well, maybe not now. You know, do another contemporary book, which I thought the Wednesday Sisters was kind of historical. It's, you know, the 1960s, which is history to me. But, I pitched a contemporary book, and then the same thing happened the next time. And so I pitched a contemporary book, and then the most recent book that I pitched to them, it was this book again. But so I retitled on the synopsis, I retitled it and I called it The Girls of Paris because I knew it was a title that they would like. And they came back and said, we love this title. Wouldn't you love to do a contemporary book with this title?
They were like totally pigeonholed. You were pigeonholed at that point, weren't you?
Well, I think that they had legitimate concerns over, you know, where your audience will go with you and that kind of thing. And I have, you know, Random House is really good to me, and I have nothing but good things to say about them. My team there was terrific. Mm-hmm. But what happened with The Race for Paris is I said, okay, sure, and I put together a proposal for a contemporary novel. And they said, great, and we agreed on, you know, all the basics. And then they sent me a contract, and they had changed their boilerplate on ebooks, on the ebook language. And so we were haggling over that for quite some time so I hadn't signed the contract yet, when I had an unfortunate connection between my finger and a carving knife. And I was left unable to type for 6 weeks, and I couldn't type new. So I dragged The Race for Paris back out of, you know, the drawer and took a look at it again. And I thought, well, this is done, I think. You know, I mean, I made some changes, but... And so I sent it to my editor, as I thought, well, they'd already always passed on a proposal. I'd never told them I had the whole novel. But so I sent them the whole novel. And my editor was not as enthusiastic about it as I would have liked. And my agent was totally, you know, wildly, madly, crazily in love with it, said it was way the best thing I'd ever written. And so she suggested that we – we consider taking, even though I love the team at Random House, consider taking it to two other editors that at other houses that she knew who she thought would be as wild about it as she were. And she sent it on a Friday night, and by Sunday we had a preemptive offer. And so I ended up at HarperCollins, moving from Random House to HarperCollins. But that was, you know, so if Random House said the first time I pitched it, you know, was in probably 2008 after the Wednesday, it was before the Wednesday Sisters published the first time, so 2006 or something. If they had said somewhere along the way, yeah, let's do that next, then it probably wouldn't have taken 15 years because I wouldn't have been writing those other novels.
They kept saying, you know, come on, you know, do this one. And of course, what are you going to say? You're going to say yes, and you're going to write them.
That's exactly right. I mean, it's such an odd and not always author-friendly publishing environment at the moment, that if you have a publisher who loves your work and is willing to give you a contract for a book that's not even written yet, that's very flattering. Yeah. You know, it's very flattering, and it's hard to say no to that. So
yeah, I don't know anybody who would, frankly. I was like, yeah, sure, I can do that. Let's do that.
Exactly.
Whatever you want.
Exactly. Yeah, and there's a great comfort in writing a book knowing it's going to be published.
Yeah.
So, you know. So then, sometimes I think, though, as writers, we have to move outside our comfort zones. And one of the things I have found as a writer is that I do my best writing when I am writing what I am most passionate about. Mm-hmm. And so I have made the decision that I am not going to write under contract anymore. I'm going to write what I want to write and then mm-hmm. hope there's an editor there for it.
Oh, okay. That's actually, you know, pretty bold. I know that, you know, for newbie writers, you know, we're thinking, you know, welcome to our world. But
well, I know. And it's the way I start. It's the way we all start, right? It's the way
that's pretty interesting to try to, you know, take it back a little bit, kind of, you know, write like when you're hungry, I'm sure it changes the dynamic of what you write and how you write, because you're going for your best ideas as opposed to, will they like this? Will they like this? Well, this is a lot like it was last time, which is what they wanted. So you're second guessing all the time, I assume.
Exactly. And you're sort of writing to somebody else's tastes because you know your editor and you know what they like, and you find yourself, you know, thinking, oh, well, will my editor like this? And that's not the right way to write. The right way to write is to, you know, as Hemingway says, you know, open a vein and let yourself bleed. And and it's hard to do that when you're looking at the color of your blood saying, will my editor like this?
Will they be excited about all this blood? That would be great. Let me ask. Hey, how about this?
Exactly. Okay, let me put a Band-Aid on that and move along, right?
So, Meg, you mentioned that you didn't, you know, you weren't a big fan of English when you were studying. How does that then translate into saying, yeah, I'm going to be a writer. I'm going to dive in and do this?
Oh, I didn't say I wasn't a big fan of English. I said I wasn't very good at it.
Well, wouldn't that still be enough to put you... I mean, I'm not good at mechanics or plumbing. I'm not going to go and start changing a car engine over or anything.
Well, so I was always a huge reader. From a very young age, I was a huge reader, and I would, you know, read, you know, 50 books over the course of a summer. So it wasn't a matter of not liking reading. It wasn't a matter of not liking literature. I was a math science girl, and the benefit of, you know, math, for example, is that you know you have the right answer when you get to the end, and you can check it, and it's a very, you know, comfortable place to be knowing that you're right, especially if you've grown up a good Catholic girl like me. Whereas when I was taking an English class, you know, the question would be, what does the bird on the line at the end of chapter 3 mean? And I would think, you know, the bird at the end on the line at the end of chapter 3 is supposed to have some meaning. I don't know what.
Damn it.
And so I didn't feel comfortable. And it felt to me when I was in English class that very often we were talking about, you know, drilling down into the details without talking about the importance of the whole story or addressing the whole story. And so I just was not really thrilled with the way my English class experience was anyway. So I would say that, you know, when I was in middle school, I would have, if somebody asked me, well, I probably never, I wouldn't have admitted it. I only admitted it to my, you know, first boyfriend back then. But my first dream, you know, what I wanted to be a writer. But one of the things that happens if you're, you know, a suburban Midwestern girl is you don't know any writers. You don't know that it's a real thing to be. And so I never considered it a realistic career option. You know, my options were, my dad's an accountant and my mom is a homemaker. My dad is a very successful accountant. He's gone into the tech industry and done very well. But he is at heart an accountant. And those were more the kinds of things that I was looking at as career, especially as a, you know, as a young woman coming of age when women were just starting in the professions.
Do you think English teachers take things too far? I've seen that thing on the net where it'll have the English teacher wants to know about the bird at the end, and then you're to explain it, and then it says at the bottom the author just says it's a damn bird.
Well, so there's this great Hemingway quote, and I'm gonna muff it, but it's something like, you know, sometimes a fish is just a fish, and a boat is just a boat, and a man is just a man, or something like that. And
Freud said sometimes a cigar is just a cigar. Yeah,
exactly. And I, you know, one of the things I think is, I think that there's I'm a big fan of metaphor. I'm less a fan of simile, but I think that if a metaphor is done really well, then it's not obvious. You know, it's more subtle than that. And I think that the way metaphors arise in writing for most of the writers I've talked to is you write the story and then you step back and then you see where the metaphors are and what you might do with them. But you don't say, well, I'm going to make this, you know, fish a metaphor for Jesus Christ or whatever. It just doesn't happen that way. It happens on a very subconscious level, and then maybe you do a little bit in the revisions to bring it up in volume a little bit more, but it's more subconscious than that, and so that's why I think it's very hard, and I think, you know, I also think that readers bring what they bring to a story. Every story is a joint effort between the reader and the writer, and what the bird means to me might be something different than what the bird means to somebody else. And I think a really good English teacher will say that's fine as long as you can say something about what the bird might mean. But I didn't
back it up. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. But I was too concerned as a young woman, especially as a girl, in having the right answer, not having an intelligent answer, and thinking everything was black and white.
We can ask an English teacher. So, Catherine,
yes,
why do you always go down that road of going, so, tell me what this passage means. What does it represent? I don't know. Nothing.
It's like it's a bird. Well, first of all, you know, 20 years, 30 years ago, there's trends in how to analyze literature. And so you get, if you're at school where there's a certain trend where there is one right answer, where there's a very prescriptive way of looking at any piece of literature, you do get that problem, Meg, that you were dealing with, which was, you know, okay, well, what does this metaphor mean? And the professor, not knowing any better, or the teacher will just say, well, I read the notes for this class for the teacher, and it says this metaphor means X. And there's no deviation because, so, you know, a bunch of really smart white male guys got together and said, that's what this is, right?
Yeah.
Well, it's shifted now so that there's, to your point, is you need to look at those metaphors and the story through, you know, through the filters of the reader. And so because I'm teaching literature right now, world literature, I'm working with students who don't have the answer. This is not their field. You know, they're just taking world literature just for, you know, for extra. Right. So they're not going to be brilliant at this because that's not their job to be brilliant at analyzing literature. So we walk through it and I said, well, in this cultural context, what do you think this means? What does it mean to you? And if so, how does this change the meaning of the story? So we come at it at a different way now. So that there is, and here's the thing that I think you said very well, there's no right answer, which for some people drives them nuts.
Right. And so when I came to,
it doesn't mean this. It's like, well, it's, you know, it's up to interpretation. Ah, and they run screaming from the room and major in physics. So, you know.
Yeah, exactly. And so I think if I, you know, if I were had been more mature when I came through all this, maybe I would have taken more English, done more English. I think if, you know, one of the things that happens is, you know, what you read in the classes you take sometimes can shape, you know, your idea of what literature is. And I mean, you know, I'm not sure that I always took the best classes, you know, went through the best options when I was younger. And so I think that if I, certainly my children who are now both mathy, in mathy careers, had far better experiences in English in high school and college than I did.
Do you think, though, with like technology, the net, internet, all that sort of thing, talking about the bird having some meaning, is less and less now? Like, for example, you know, if Catherine's lecturing and says, well, Meg Clayton's book on Paris is, it represents, you know, capturing your life and in the, you know, surrounded by war. And then someone raises their hand and says, well, actually, according to the interview that Meg did only last week, it doesn't mean that at all. Like, does it make it more accessible because also authors can respond to these things that they see via comments? And, you know, if someone else puts a comment up saying, oh, it represents this, you can actually say, well, actually, no, it doesn't.
I think that's a really good point. I think that the accessibility of information on the internet makes the analysis of literature as a right answer kind of thing both, you know, one, it's a lot easier to Google and find what, you know, is widely accepted as the right answer, whether it's right or not. Mm. And two, you just have a wealth of discussion available to you so you can look at literature more broadly. And I think that's a really terrific thing for sure.
Because
I agree. If they come up with it, students say, hey, I just noticed this on the internet. Here's the interview with the author. Or, you know, what I try to do is, you know, I bring in writers. You mentioned David Sedaris. I saw him live last year. And, I bring in a piece of his. We can talk about it because I've heard him speak. I get where he's coming from. There's some background. And then you can guide that conversation because you've had some, you know, conversation with the author. You know, you've said, yeah, well, I happen to know that this is how it works. I'm very good at teaching poetry because I am a poet. So I can say, sometimes you don't know what you wrote.
Right.
Oh, it's all about this. And as an author, you say, God, that's so profound. That's not where I was going at all, but that's great.
I have to say that, you know, my best reader, my two best readers are my husband and my best writer friend, who's a writer named Brenda Rickman Vantries. She's a wonderful historical fiction writer. Her first novel is called The Illuminator. She's got three now. They're wonderful books. But, you know, I write something and then I get it far enough along and then I send it to Brenda. And she and Brenda and Mac, and they both tell me, oh, and I love the way you did this and this is so. And I'm like, oh, that was, you know, I didn't realize I was doing that, but I do love that, you know, and so they will point out to me what is working and why in a way where I just wrote it, you know, it came out on a very subconscious level for me, and I don't always focus on, you know, what is working or why. It's often hard to see that in your own work.
The beta reader idea is huge, and I have a good strong team. Some people are right here with us
who
read my early work and say that didn't work or that did work. Super helpful because we can't see it, and I agree with you.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Cool. Also, because you know your characters are at least for. If you're doing a good job of writing, your characters are very fully developed in your mind and they're very alive in your mind. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you can't tell how much of that is actually on the paper and how much of it is still just in your mind. And when you're reading the words on the page, you don't realize how your characters are coming across.
Because you filled it in your head.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think all of us do that. It's like, well, really? And I didn't put that down because this is what they were thinking. And your beta reader's looking at you saying, I'm not seeing this. You're going to have to write some more.
Right. Well, here's the thing. If you saw a comment, if someone, you know, posts up that they found a metaphor in your book and it means this and that, and you're thinking, that's way off, but that's so creative. I love that. Would you ever hijack that? So if someone else asked you down the track and said, so, you know, does that represent, you know, the birds and freedom? You're like, yeah, totally. Of course it does.
So again, I think that the best writing happens on a very subconscious level, where you don't necessarily know what you're doing. And I will tell you that my friend Brenda says, you know, she knows me better than even I know myself, because she knows me very well, and then she's read everything I've written, and so she knows me better through my writing than I know myself. Because she can see what's there in ways that I can't always. And I think that that's not untrue. I think that there are things in my writing that are very revealing of myself personally that I don't even realize, you know, I've put out there. And so I think sometimes somebody else commenting on something that I've written is going to bring a wisdom to it that I don't necessarily. So I love reading what people's reactions, well, except for, you know, the 1 stars on Amazon. Nobody likes those, right?
Actually, I had a look at one. I'm talking about 1 star. Obviously, you've seen them. And someone else has left a comment, because this sort of did make me chuckle a little bit. 1 star review for the race to Paris is, I passed it on to my daughter. Now...
Okay, it's like every time I read this, I hate it. What are we doing here?
So this it creates more question than anything. They give you 1 star, but they pass it on to their daughter. Does that mean that they can't stand their own child enough to give them the book? I feel sorry for the daughter.
I think one of the things that happens sometimes is my writing, all my novels have female protagonists, without exception. Sometimes there are as a major male character as well. Like in The Race for Paris, there is one major male character, but the novel is really centered on two women journalists. It's really the story of two women journalists and a guy who helps them. I like to say a guy who, you know, shows up with a Jeep when they need a Jeep. So and has a nice British accent. I think that, you know, as an American society anyway, I think that girls are raised, because the American literary canon is very, as Catherine said earlier, white and male and older, that's what we think of as great literature, and those are guy stories about men. And so if you're writing a story about a woman, often a male reader will have two reactions to it. One, I don't want to read about women. They're not interesting to me. Or two, you know, stories about women can't be great stories because, hey, they're about women. And so I think, you know, and that comment, this is very funny, you know, I passed it on to my daughter. Well, I'm gathering that that's probably a male reader. I don't know anything about it, but I'm gathering that's probably a male reader. And it does say something about it that he didn't hate it so much that he wasn't going to pass it around onto his daughter, or else, as you say, he has a very tortured relationship with his daughter.
Yeah, but the other, and you know, you've got, if you're not going to read them out, but you've got a lot of reviews on Amazon. It's a sign of, you know, you're a successful author and it's all going good. But most of them are all 5 and 4 stars. And then you get like one-star review that says this was poorly written, which says to me, how does that person write? If that's what they base it on, that, well, hang on, there's this person that has got, in one case, you've got 366 reviews of people going, brilliantly written, really loved it, blah blah blah, and then one person going, no, it's crap, it's really badly written. Well, hang a minute, these people must use their one there for everything, and the one
for
here
everything.
For everything.
One word, just use it for all of it. Yeah.
You know, I think the internet is interesting in that it, you know, it does give people, everybody, a forum to express their opinion, and that can be a good thing. You know, I'll tell you, there's a very funny piece that Dan Shaun, the writer Dan Shaun, wrote on Amazon 1-star reviews, which gets very much to the heart of, you know, we all like to say, oh, we don't read them, whatever, but the heart of how much and even a poorly thought out 1-star review hurts the writer. Often I think that people who are writing that stuff, they are not thinking that there is somebody else on the other end of that, somebody who wrote that, who might be, you know, reacting to it. But you know, the flip side is that the crowdsourcing of novels can allow a book that might not have been getting a lot of attention to bubble up in the you know, in the culture and find an audience where it might not have otherwise. And, you know, we're all entitled to our opinions, so whatever.
Right. So do you, if you read a book, do you feel inclined to leave a 1 or 2 star review if it's terrible, or do you just move on?
I will tell you that as a writer, I think a couple of things. One, I think that the fact that a book hasn't worked for me does not necessarily reflect on its merit. It might work really well for somebody else. You know, the things that I connect with are different from the things that somebody else connects with. Mm-hmm. And so something that might be a 1-star book for me might be a 5-star book for somebody else. So I think that's one point. And then the other point is that I think that, you know, it's an accomplishment to write a book. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of patience. It takes, you know, a lot of time in the chair when you might be, you know, drinking margaritas with your sweetheart. And so I have great respect for the accomplishment of having written a book. And so my feeling on reviewing books is I 5-star review or I do not review. If I love a book, I will 5-star review it. If I just won't even give a 4-star. If I think it doesn't deserve 5 stars, then I just will not review it.
Have you left a 5-star review somewhere and had that author contact you and go, oh my God, Meg Clayton, Have you ever had that experience?
So it's pretty anonymous, the reviewing process, I think. So I don't, I've certainly had, I will tell you that, because I write reviews sometimes, that kind of thing. I did have, you know, one of my literary friendships. It's with a wonderful writer whose name is Meg Waite. The way Meg and I connected, she's in New York. I'm in Palo Alto on the West Coast. Mm. I did a review of one of her mother's books. And she contacted me through Twitter and said, I saw the review of my mom's book for Ms. Magazine, or I think it was for Ms. And she said, I just wanted to say, you know, the book hasn't gotten much attention and she really appreciates it and I really appreciate it. And thanks.
Nice.
And so then, you know, she was coming out to the West Coast for something, and I think I couldn't go then because I was out of town, but a mutual friend got me a copy of her book, and then I was coming to New York, and she said, oh, let's have dinner, and we all had dinner with a couple of mutual friends, and now we're part of something we loosely call the Margarita Gang, which is a gang that gets together for margaritas when we're all in town together, and it's really nice. So, yeah, I think, you know, I think all writers appreciate kind words about their novels. About their books, and I've certainly had many writers who I've, you know, blurb their books or whatever, reach out and say thank you in very appreciative ways.
Yeah.
What about when something is, and this is my problem, my personal problem, is because I have to say it's terrible if it is.
He's such a good beta reader.
Well, that's different, you know. That's different. A private forum versus a public forum, right?
You see, but that's where the line gets a bit blurry. So then Catherine does her beta test to everyone, and that's meant to be closed. And then I start the show and go, welcome to the Newbie Writers Podcast. Catherine, what the hell did you send me? And it just...
So it's sort of private, sort of not.
She's like, well, what do you mean? But, yeah, I don't know. If you see something... this is, and it gets into that realm. We've spoken a lot about this of fake reviews and that sort of thing, where you see something that's clearly terrible, it's got a lot of spelling errors, it's just poorly written, and then they have a lot of people saying, this is amazing, I loved this book, so well written, and you're sitting there going, are you for real? And that's where my brain just goes blank, and then I log off and go, oh, that's right, I just left an abusive review. I don't know. Anyway,
I can respect that point of view, and I just don't do it. You know, part of it is I just think there is so much negativity on the internet that I hate to contribute to it.
Oh, yeah. I love it.
You're probably cleverer at the snark than I am. You know, if I could be snarkly clever, I would probably do it too.
Look, it takes practice. Chris, I have for you is you've got a couple of books, The Wednesday Daughters and The Wednesday Sisters. Why Wednesday, not Tuesday?
Yeah, well, you know, that's a good question. I think that, you know, the first of those was called The Wednesday Sisters. And I will tell you, the way that book started is it was just a file in my computer, The Wednesday Sisters. That all it was an empty file with that title on it. And I could not tell you why Wednesday as opposed to Tuesday. I will tell you that the book opens with a line saying, you know, basically, we're the Wednesday sisters. We meet on Sundays, if that makes you feel any better. but I think that probably what happened was I saw, you know, in a, you know, things come to you in weird ways and you just write them down, right? I'm not sure where that came from, but my guess is that it came from something like, you know, reading someplace on Wednesday, sisters, Anna and Paige went to, you know, or are hosting a something or something like that. And I saw the juxtaposition of the words together and thought, The Wednesday Sisters, that would be a good title for a book. Yeah. And then that's, and so I had, it was so long ago, and it was more than a year before I even started writing the book, had any idea what the book might be about, that I have no recollection of where the title came from, only that, that was always the title. It started as the title. It was the first thing I ever had for the book. And the one thing nobody ever wanted to change in that book was the title.
It's a good title. And I like your opening line of saying, you know, we're the Wednesday sisters, but we meet on a Sunday. And it gets me thinking about that opening line. Do you spend a lot of time on that? When, once the book's finished, do you go back to that opening line and see, does this hook the person in?
Oh my God, you would not believe how much time I could spend on an opening line. I mean, I would say that, you know, I go through a lot of drafts of books. I would say The Race for Paris went through probably, you know, close to 100 drafts by the time I was done with it because I worked on it for such a long time. But the opening line, I'm not even sure. I think, hold on, I have the arc and the final copy in front of me. I think that the opening line changed between the advanced reader copy and the final copy even. It is often the last thing I revise is the opening line, and I revise it again and again and again. I know for the Wednesday Sisters, I spent an entire 2 days in Nashville with my friend Brenda going over the opening two paragraphs, just revising them and trying to get them right.
Wow.
And because it is, it's a very, it's your invitation for the reader into the story. Mm. And like everything else, we all have more things to do than we have time to do them. And if you, you know, if you pick up a book and you don't like the opening line, you're most likely going to put it down. And so that opening line is really, really important. And the opening line for The Race for Paris, for example, there was a lot I wanted to get done there. And there was too much in the sentence, and I kept trying to take out different pieces and finally settled on something. And I'm actually looking at the arc and the final copy. And so your arc is, you know, you think you're done with it and you're just supposed to be changing, fixing typos and stuff. Mm-hmm. And the sentence is indeed slightly different.
Oh, yeah.
So, because we've not really explored this, have we, Catherine, the whole opening line thing. Is there a certain length that it needs to be just to try and – it's almost like a quick snapshot to either make you smile or think, ooh, that was a bit interesting.
I don't think so. I think, you know, like one of the great opening lines is call me Ishmael, right? Three words, that's it. So I think what's really important in an opening line is to establish the voice of the novel. And if you can establish a voice that appeals to people, then they will follow you for quite some way, whether, you know, almost no matter where you're taking them. And so that's what I think is really important. And the thing about opening lines is, you know, as a writer, usually they're the first thing you write. And often when you write them, you don't have a really good idea where the book is going. Sometimes the book ends up going someplace different. And then you look back at that opening line and you think, that is not anything about the book.
Yeah.
I'm a purist. And so one of the things I love is, you know, in the perfect novel, the opening paragraph is kind of like a preview of the book, kind of begins and ends in the way that the book begin, that the whole book will begin and end. And so that's what I strive for. I don't always make it. Sometimes my editors talk me out of it. But that's what, that is my ideal of how to write an opening paragraph. And I'm just looking at the opening paragraph of the when of the Race for Paris, and it starts with an opening sentence that's a sets up the scene in a lot of ways and kind of tells you a bit about who this is and how they're telling the story. And I will tell you that the closing line of that paragraph echoes the theme of the book.
So you shouldn't really start your book with "Once upon a time."
It was a dark and stormy night.
Right.
Well, Catherine, did you deliberate over the opening sentence of all of the Future Gold stuff?
Oh yeah, because the Future Gold, we had to change the whole first opening. We had to change the whole first chapter.
Yes,
because.
That's right.
I sent it off to you and Yuji, and it was one of those moments where you just said, "Oh, this is crap." Rethink that. And one of the reasons that I wrote Future Sky so quickly was because I picked it up at the very I picked up where the Future Run ended, and just started it right up. And the opening line was really strong, and it just, again, you're right, Meg. You just that launched. You know, everything else. Now I'll probably go back and tweak it. And I think too, sometimes you're, when you're all done with your book, you can say, "Oh, you know what? I could reflect this." And then you retweak a little bit on the opening line again. So I agree. I think it takes some time and some craft to really focus on it. However, since we're talking to newbie writers, do not spend 4 weeks writing the first sentence if you haven't written the rest of the book.
Mm. I totally agree with that. I think, I will tell you that for my first novel, I spent a lot of time on the opening chapters in a story, and then, you know, finished the whole book and then went back and realized that, you know, the entire first three chapters just needed to go. Just needed to be chopped off. I needed to start it where chapter four started, and that was the story. And I think that you can spend a lot of time, waste a lot of time trying to make something perfect as you go forward before you even know what the story's about. I had the opportunity to study with Alice McDermott, the National Book Award winner for Charming Billy. It was just a fabulous writer, I think. Three or four of her books have been finalists for the National Book Award, and then she's won it once. And she told me, and I happened to have the opportunity to study with her when I was writing my first novel. She looked at the first, I think it was 100 pages of it. And she told me, in the context of talking about those pages, that she typically writes a couple hundred pages at the beginning of the book that end up being, you know, 30 pages, 50 pages at the end of the, at the beginning of the book, that there's, that she writes a lot as she's finding the story. And then she, pares it down to what the reader needs to know. Cause the writer needs to know a lot more than the reader needs to know early on in the writing, in a writing project. And I have always, embrace that because it can be really hard to pitch your words, right? Especially if you've got a nice sentence, you know, you think, oh, I really like that sentence. So one of the things I do is when I start pruning the beginning of the book, which I always do, if there are clauses, sentences, whatever that I particularly like, I take them out and I hold them in a file because it makes them easier to take out. And then sometimes I will look for places to work them back in. And that's very satisfying because if you've, you know, come up with a nice, you know, something you like, you don't have to pitch it just because you're pitching the whole chapter or the whole section or the whole paragraph or whatever. And that's kind of liberating.
Yeah.
I do like moving things around. I think that once you know what a story is about, you can take the pieces of telling it and move them around a little bit. And sometimes you get more effective storytelling.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Well, that sort of happened with like Catherine's book. I found that I was reading that first chapter and I'm going, I don't need to know how they're setting the table and putting knives and forks down. But then the last paragraph, I think I put the note going, your story starts here.
Yeah, you might very well have. Yeah. No, and you also said it wasn't interesting. So I said, all right, fine. I'll just have a big explosion at the beginning. And so that's what I did. Three words into the opening of the book. It's like, okay, and then it all exploded. And then everybody else who read it said, much better. Let's just go with the explosion.
Because you want to be engaged straight away. You want to find out why
Absolutely.
Did something explode.
And it's harder and harder to grab attention. So we do want to spend some time in those first, chapter. Because it's too easy to reject it. It's too easy for people to say, nah, not doing it for me, I'm out. Nah, not doing it for me, I'm out. So we have to spend time on it. But then you counterbalance that with getting the job done before you go back and start reiterating and crafting that first chapter. You want to make sure you have the whole story so you know what the first chapter is supposed to set up the reader to find.
That's right. And I think if you can get something going on in the first chapter, Tim O'Brien calls the happeningness of the story, something actually happening, then you can have like a little eddy and fill in with some information that maybe the reader needs to know. But you do need to engage them, whether it's a voice that engages them or whether it's a piece of action that draws them in or whatever. You need to engage your reader from the very beginning. I think I know from agents and editors that I've talked to that they just get so many submissions and they have so little time that, if the first line doesn't work, they're very likely to set it down. It's true for short stories. It's true for novels. It's true for op-eds. It's true for everything. Your first line is just so important. Your opening is so important. Your first chapter is so important.
Well, can we put that down as your ultimate newbie tip? Or do you have another
one? Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, my ultimate newbie tip is actually to continue to believe in yourself long beyond the point when even your mother has given up on you. I think that publishing is a marathon, and if you come to the starting line with only a sprint in you, then you're doing yourself an injustice. And I think that just keeping at it, we all get better as writers. We all improve with the effort, and if you give up, then you've given up and it's done. Especially if it's your dream, being a writer, sometimes I pinch myself like, oh my God, this is my life. I cannot
How
even
cool
believe
is this,
it.
Right?
Yeah, how cool is this? Exactly. And there's so many, it took me 10 years to get my first novel published. And there are so many times when I look back and I think, but for somebody's kind words somewhere along the way, I might have just chucked it and gone back to, the practice of law or something. So I think continuing to believe in yourself is really, really important.
Awesome. Thank you, Meg, for being on. We've got some other segments we'd love you to stick around for. Where can people find your books, you, everything?
I hope you can find my books just about at any bookstore. The Race for Paris is in hardcover. Everything else is in paperback. I'm delighted to say that everything is still in print. Everything is available on ebook. All but my first novel are available as an audiobook if your listeners like audiobooks. And they can see more about it, find links to buying and that kind of thing on my website, which is either megwayclayton.com or raceforparis.com.
Well, if they're up at audible.com, if people put in audibletrial.com/newbiewriters, they'll probably end up getting it for free. So,
yeah.
Go do that.
Maybe so.
All right. Great. Well, some people like prompts. Should we do a prompt, Catherine?
Sure, we can do a prompt. I have a long prompt.
Oh, all right.
I love that. Thanks for, really, thank you for the support. I'm working, I don't know about, I know you don't, Damien, but maybe you do, Meg. It says I create a holiday newsletter every year for my friends, and it's more widely read and praised than my novels, which is lovely. I think the reason is because it's personal and readers know the family. And so how can your fiction characters have more personality? You know, think about how to infuse them with some personality. What would their Christmas letter say? Would there be photos? Is your character standing before a dragon, taking a selfie, saying another one this year? Did your character take a long shot of the sea and writing left again on the shore? Should I stop dating sea captains? What do you think? What kind of Christmas letter would, or holiday letter, would your main character create?
I've had an idea now, because I think, Sharon's family do the Christmas letter. How awkward would it be? Like, we get them all as well, and it's, you know, Billy graduated from school and John did this, and, you know, he's got a promotion in his job. If then they read ours and it was like, Agonar crushed the enemy on the plains of such and such while swooping in on a dragon, and just...
I think that would be great. And I used to write very, very snarky ones when when the boys were little, just short of fictionalizing. Although I have to say, when they were little, they gave me a lot of material to work with. so I, would write, everybody, so-and-so just, stop picking his nose. We're so excited. just really horrible things, because it just, that was where we were. That was our space. Well, now I'm, I'm more responsible for, girls who have married into the family, and I don't want to be, too awful about that. You have to be more cautious, which is another thought. What happens when you have to be really cautious and consider your audience and consider the people you're discussing? I can see why people who write memoir get absolutely, stymied, because they're like, oh my God, I can't say anything mean. These people know me. They know where I live.
Well, I don't know. You could just put on your Christmas letter, I went back in time. If you're reading this, didn't go so well.
I like that.
All right, let's do a word of the week. Now, you've got a word of the week from somewhere else this time. Threw me for a spin. So words don't mean what they used to. There's a link, it's a long one, sfgate.com. So the word this week is bump. It used to be a thing that slowed down traffic or inspired you to buy concealer. Now a bump is a verb to move an online post or thread to the top of the reverse chronological list by adding a new comment or post to the thread. So yes, I've used the term bump a bit. It's usually for those people that don't really understand forums, though. So a forum is one of those static things. You post a question up or an answer to something. Normally the person posting the question will bump it if they don't get an answer straight away. So like an hour will go past, not bump. Like, seriously. Most people on this, it's a worldwide thing. Someone might get to this tomorrow.
Time zones are not people's strong suits, just saying.
No, don't post up on a forum, I've got water spilling out of my toilet, what should I do? And then 10 minutes later go, bump, it's filling up the bathroom.
Perhaps this is not the place to ask this question.
No, that's right. Anyway, let's do a tortured sentence.
Sure.
Next time, don't put the Roman vases on the right slab. Tortured sentences.
So that was taken from when Meg was studying to be a doctor, and then she went, whoa, lawyer looks good right now.
I think we'll go for attorney, much less lead. So this is the... I just have loved this section, The World According to Student Bloopers, from Richard Lederer from St. Paul School, who very kindly, put these all out. And where did it go? Here we go. The winter of 1620 was a hard one for the settlers. Many people died and many babies were born. Captain John Smith was responsible for all of this.
Damn you, John.
That's why John is so popular in the States.
Yes. You horny murderer.
Yep.
Just be careful of the syntax.
My God. It just doesn't make sense.
I know. And then you had a torture sentence.
I did. I'll get to that in a minute. But it's more of a shout out. Meg, is there anyone you want to give a shout out to before we head off?
Anyone I want to give a shout out to? Yeah, I want to give a shout out to Elizabeth Brundage, who is a writer friend of mine who has a fabulous book coming out in March called All Things. Now I'm going to come up with the name of it. Hold on. I just started reading the arc, and it's really, really fabulous. So hold on, I'm going to get you the name of it.
Yeah, do.
I am very terrible at names of things. It is called All Things Cease to Appear, a novel, and it is it has a killer opening line.
If you open
the book and start to read it, I think you will not put down the book. And of course, it is on my nightstand. Shall I grab it it for you?
Go get it for us, and we'll do a shout out while you do that.
Right. Well, I want to give a shout out to the person that sent me a couple of emails that said, and they sent it from an anonymous email, so I can't respond to them. That's fine. Hopefully, they're listening. It says Dion's voice is cute. Replace that mean old man with the cute and wonderful Dion. And then I got another one.
Are you sure that's not from Dion herself?
Yeah, well, I asked her, so no, it wasn't me. And then I got another one saying, by mean old man, I do mean Damien, because everyone hates Damien. So in official response to that, I'd like to play this. Anyway.
You only play a mean old man on the podcast.
Thanks for listening. Send me another one. Anyway, Catherine.
So did you find the opening line?
Yeah, it's actually, I'm reading now, and it's actually a whole opening scene, and so I can't really read it. But I'll tell you that it starts with a little introduction. It's setting the scene. This is the Hale Farm. Goes on, and it says, here is the house. Noisy with stories. And she had me from Noisy with Stories. It's such a nice way to describe a house. It's kind of like turns out to be kind of a haunted house where a lot of bad things have happened. And it's just really lovely.
Yeah. Cool. Well, there you go.
So, very cool.
Check that out. All right. Well,
thank you, Meg, so much for coming on our show. I really appreciate it. Love the book.
My pleasure. Thank you, Catherine. Thank you, Damien. It's been a lovely chat.
Yes,
we promised lovely.
You survived. Who have we got on next? Great. We don't have anyone on next week.
We don't have anybody on next week. You are on vacation, and I'm shopping on Black Friday. Thank you very much.
Yes, so it'll be the week after. And if I'm right, we're going to have Carla Caruso on. Is that right?
Yes, we are. Because that's who you were talking to when we said, so what do you do? I have a podcast for writers.
Yes.
Tell us all about that.
Yep. So she's going to be on. That's going to be good. Another local author. She don't have too many of them on here, so can't wait for that.
I find more than you do. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, I know. That's all right. Anyway. So, yes, until next week. Well,
until next week.
Till the week after. 2 weeks. We'll see you then.
Your book starts here on the Newbie Writers Podcast.